Penguin Random House Audio presents Outsmarting the Sociopath Next Door, How to Protect Yourself Against a Ruthless Manipulator by Martha Stout, Ph.D. Read for you by Cassandra Campbell. For my mother, Martha Eva Deaton Stout, 1923 to 2018. Beautiful, more brilliant than she realized, and above all, the kindest and most loving person I have ever known. Each one of us must take responsibility for our own lives, and above all, show respect and love for living things around us, especially each other. Jane Goodall, Reason for Hope. Prologue. Dueling with the Devil. Dressed in a paint-stained shirt and frayed jeans, and intent on cleaning the underside of a deck, I was certainly not looking the part of a professional psychologist one spring afternoon when a shiny new SUV bearing two young children and their well-dressed mother appeared in my driveway. The woman was wearing neatly applied makeup. Still, she looked as if she had been crying for days, and my heart went out to her. Obviously relieved to have found me, despite my torn jeans and my initial astonishment, she said she had traveled 2 hours to get to the town she could only speculate was mine. She told me that she was involved in a custody battle from hell with someone who was frighteningly cold-blooded, and that she feared for the well-being of her daughter and son. "To save my children," she said, "I've got to duel with the devil, and I don't know how." She was certain that her ex-husband did not really want to be a father, and that he was suing for custody only to keep her under his thumb, which, given her love and concern for the children, he was accomplishing quite handily. I explained the power of presenting a serene, rather than panicky, demeanor whenever she encountered her ex-husband, to thwart his desire for visible evidence that he was controlling her emotions, and provided her with some suggestions to help her speak productively with her lawyer. When she left, I was glad to see that, replacing the hopelessness, there was a glimmer of resolve in her eyes. As a psychologist, I had studied sociopathy and treated clinically traumatized victims for more than 25 years. And still, I did not fully appreciate the overwhelming prevalence of sociopathic victimization until I began to write about it. Since my book, The Sociopath Next Door, was published in 2005, I have been flooded with phone calls and letters from readers who have felt compelled to tell me of their own encounters with people who appear to have no conscience. So motivated have these readers been to tell me their stories that some have managed to acquire my unlisted home phone number or have waited outside my office door in Boston, hoping to catch me coming or going. But this was the first time someone had appeared at my house. I decided to establish a website with a dedicated email address so my readers could relate their experiences without having to embark on such desperate searches. As soon as I did, I began to receive a seemingly endless torrent of messages from all over the world. Most of the people who contacted me, and who continue to do so daily, are dealing with a possible sociopath who is simply not avoidable. The opposing party in a custody battle, a boss or a coworker in a job too valuable to leave, an adult in their family, or, in perhaps the most excruciating situation of all, one of their own children. The readers who seek me out are from both genders and many different walks of life, but they have certain experiences in common. They have all felt alone and more than a little crazy. Each has believed him or herself to be the only person ever fooled and manipulated by a human being who turned out to possess an alien mind. They have survived a reality-shattering relationship with at least one person incapable of guilt, remorse, or even concern. And until they read The Sociopath Next Door, all of these survivors had assumed that no one would believe their strange story. My book had given them the concepts and the words to describe their experiences. Now they were searching for tools to protect themselves and their loved ones. It is for them, and for all people who find themselves in unavoidable struggles with the conscienceless, that I have written this book on how to prevail against a sociopath. Nearly all the letters I have received over the years fall naturally into a few categories. And in media appearances and private conversations since 2005, I have been asked countless questions on these same crucial topics. In this book, I will discuss all of them. The grim reality of sociopathic children and how to deal with them. Specific methods you can use to overcome a sociopath who has targeted you at work. What to do when, terrifyingly, your opponent in a child custody struggle is a sociopath. Assaultive sociopaths, including cyber assault. And the differences between a sociopath and a narcissist. The book also includes a chapter on sociopathy in our corporations and governments, and thoughts on the nature of good. Most conscienceless people, seeking to blend in with the rest of society and not wanting to be caught or imprisoned, commit invisible moral and interpersonal crimes. Contrary to popular misconceptions, sociopaths who turn to lethal violence are a small minority. They are far more likely to be destructive liars and manipulators who play brutal psychological, financial, and political games with our lives. They comprise the single largest subgroup of domestic abusers, people who attempt to enhance their sense of power and control by beating up on spouses, children, and the elderly in the privacy of their homes. This is one of the reasons we find them so difficult to identify. But when sociopaths do murder, the results disturb us deeply. I'll discuss the pattern seen in murderous sociopathic behavior and how this form of aggression is motivated differently from non-sociopathic violence. Psychologists are loath to recommend avoidance as the solution to a problem. But where sociopathy is concerned, avoidance is actually the optimal course. Whether violent or not, sociopaths live outside of the social contract that binds the rest of us, are uniquely destructive, and will never be able to engage in authentic personal or work relationships with anyone. Their sole preoccupation is to have power over other people, and the most advisable and least dangerous course of action is to avoid such people altogether. However, steering clear of the sociopath is not always possible. In this book, I will provide you with tools for dealing with the sociopath you simply cannot avoid. You will read stories inspired by the many, many letters I was sent, accounts from people who watched in shock as the scaffolding of accepted human reality fell from beneath them, and who bravely tried to rescue themselves and the people they loved in a world that no longer made sense. They were forced to learn that sociopaths are more than just abstractions in a fleeting newscast or the subject of a shocking documentary. They are human beings who look like everyone else, so well camouflaged that their true nature may have gone unrecognized for years or even decades. While I've changed all names and any identifying details in these stories, you'll find examples of individuals who have triumphed, men and women who have dealt successfully with people who appeared to have no conscience, but also sad and even frightening stories in which the ruthless seem to win in the end. Whether they conclude in success or in travesty, all of the stories illustrate the ways in which our traditional ideas about evil have blinded us to its true nature. Evil behavior emanates from an emotional hole, and being unaware of this has severely limited our ability to deal with ruthlessness in our day-to-day lives and in our society. The real-world-based accounts in this book affirm that a new, rational understanding of the leading source of human evil, the characterological and neuropsychological absence of conscience, could give us a crucial advantage as we deal with sociopathic people in our lives, and as we face the human-mediated problems of our age. I believe that for our personal safety, and indeed for the well-being of the planet we live on, we must abandon our mistaken beliefs, our sociopathy blindness, and take a useful stance grounded in knowledge and competence. We must learn that despite their trademark lack of emotion, Sociopaths are emotion eaters. They have an intense desire to witness their control over us by inciting our confusion, anger, and fear. They feed off the negative emotions of others. Knowing when and how not to display emotion, how to remain calm in the presence of a sociopath rather than feeding him with our immediate feelings, is a vital skill. He is playing a terrible game with you, but I will show you how to change the rules of the game. In The Sociopath Next Door, I coined the first...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.